Welcome viewers, today we will be discussing on the topic cloning vectors. So what are cloning vectors? Vectors means short stretch of DNA which is capable of autonomous replication when it gets inside a host cell. They are used for introducing any gene of interest from any source. When added to it, it forms a recombinant DNA, and that recombinant DNA when gets inside a host cell makes many copies of that desired gene. Using this vectors only, we are in a position to overexpress insulin gene inside a bacterial system. So let's have a look onto the entire story of cloning. What do we understand by the term cloning? Cloning means to select a particular gene and make multiple copies of that gene, taking help of cloning vectors. Cloning vectors are used, and therein we introduce the insert DNA from different sources and they are joined together to form a recombinant DNA. After that, this recombinant DNA is introduced inside a suitable host by the mechanism of transformation, transfection or transduction. Once this recombinant DNA gets inside their suitable hosts, it makes many copies of that gene. Thereby, we can get hold of many copies of our desired gene. This method can be procured by two different ways. One is cell-based cloning, as I discussed just now, and the second one is by polymerase chain reaction. By means of cloning, we are in a position to overexpress a protein using expression vectors. So let's have a look on the steps of cloning. Number one step is cutting the DNA at precise location using restriction endonucleases. Second one, selecting a small molecule of DNA or carrier DNA which is capable of self-replication. Third one is joining these two DNA fragments, taking help of enzyme called ligase which forms covalent linkage between the carrier molecule and the gene of interest. And the next step is this recombinant DNA that is formed is to be introduced inside suitable host cells by means of transformation, transfection and transduction. And finally, we need to select those cells that received the recombinant DNA. So precisely, if you follow the steps, herein we have got a cloning vector. The easiest cloning vector that is used is a plasmid. And the second one is a eukaryotic chromosome wherein we are going to select the gene of our interest. This cloning vector is cleaved with a suitable restriction endonuclease. Similarly, the eukaryotic chromosome is also cleaved with restriction endonucleases. These two fragments are then ligated inside and leads to the formation of a recombinant DNA. This recombinant vector is next then introduced inside the host cell. And as it gets inside the host cell, it propagates inside the host cell, and this leads to the completion of cloning. You can see here, cloning vectors share four common properties. Number one, the ability to promote autonomous replication. Number two, cloning requires existence of genetic markers inside the cloning vehicles for their suitable selection. Number three, it needs unique restriction endonuclease cleavage recognition sites for the introduction of foreign DNA. And finally, minimal amount of non-essential DNA is to be allowed to exist to facilitate cloning. So, we will be starting up the journey on cloning vectors. Choice of a cloning vector depends on the amount of DNA, or rather the size of the DNA that you want to clone inside a cloning vehicle. So the easiest cloning vehicle, that is method of choice, is plasmids. What are they? They are covalently closed circular DNA which is capable of autonomous replication. Usually bacteria may have got autonomously replicating plasmids inside them. Some plasmids may be present inside bacteria in many copies. You will see there, they are usually in the size range 1.2 kb to 3 kb. It contains an origin of replication, a gene that permits its selection. Herein, that gene is ampicillin resistance gene, which codes for an enzyme called beta-lactamase, which cleaves the beta-lactam ring of the ampicillin antibiotic. As a result of which, the bacteria that procures the plasmid becomes resistant towards ampicillin. And this is the way to select the plasmid. And there is exogenous DNA that can be inserted into the bracketed region. You can see here. This is the place wherein the exogenous DNA can be introduced. Next step is why these elements are required. One by one, selective marker. Selective marker is required for the maintenance of the plasmid in the cell. In other way, it provides a selective advantage to the bacterial cell, whereby the bacteria, after receiving the plasmid, gets a survival advantage. And this is the reason that it will allow the existence of this vector, DNA or cloning vector inside the host cell. You can see here the existence of origin of replication. As I said, that the cloning vector plasmid should be capable of autonomous replication. It carries on replication in an independent fashion. Next, the important point, as I said, the existence of multiple cloning sites. It basically comprises of unique restriction endonuclease recognition sites, which are absent anywhere else within the vector DNA. Means within this region, we can introduce the gene of interest without cleaving the vector or without losing the integrity of the vector. Next is, there are certain vectors wherein this unique restriction endonuclease sites may not be present naturally. Under such circumstances, we create restriction endonuclease cleavage sites and we call them as polylinker sequences, and they are artificially introduced inside the cloning vehicle. Next, a model plasmid that was used for the first time called PBR322. Where BR stands for Bolivar and Roderick, the founder of this plasmid. You can see here that it comprises of restriction endonuclease unique sites. It also has got resistance genes for ampicillin and tetracycline. What is done when we want to clone a gene inside a PBR322 vector? You see that there exists a PST1 site. PBR322 is cleaved with PST1 and we introduce the foreign DNA, which is also digested with PST1. After that, you will see that this recombinant DNA is introduced inside the host cell. But as you know that the PST1 site has been used to introduce the foreign DNA, we select the transformants in presence of tetracycline. And in tetracycline plate, we will get colonies which contain either the only plasmid or the plasmid plus insert, means the recombinant DNA. Now we really need to select those cells that have received the recombinant plasmid and not the only plasmid. For this, we carry on a replica plating. How it is done? That agar plate containing tetracycline, the colonies that we are getting are lifted up and they are replica plated on plate containing ampicillin and tetracycline. So that the colonies with recombinant plasmid is called as the control and agar containing ampicillin and tetracycline. So the cells that grow on tetracycline but not on tetracycline plus ampicillin containing plates are basically the recombinant plasmids. As because the ampicillin site is being disrupted because of introduction of the foreign DNA. Now, you have seen a model for cloning gene inside a plasmid vector, but it has got certain limitations. Number one, that it cannot accept larger fragments. It can accept fragments up to the range of 0 to 10 kb. And standard methods of transformation are inefficient, means transformation efficiency is poor in case of plasmids. So we need to look for some other cloning vehicles. In this regard, the most important helper is bacteriophage lambda. Bacteriophage lambda has got a genome size of 48.5 kb. It infects E. coli cells and it has got a 12 base pair single-stranded overhang or sticky ends which can circularize. And the most interesting part about it is that it can naturally infect the bacterial cells. So, the method of introduction of any foreign DNA utilizing this bacteriophage lambda is a very good method with a better transformation efficiency. So let's have a look that the key factors about Lambda as a cloning vehicle is that about 1/3 of its genome is non-essential and can be replaced with foreign DNA. The bacteriophage Lambda then permits the cloning of almost 23 kb of DNA inside it. The DNA can be packaged by in vitro packaging, and the recombinant DNA can be easily introduced inside the bacterial cell by means of natural infection. So you can see here that there can be two different types of cloning vehicles utilizing Lambda. Replacement vector, other one is called as insertion vector. If I look into the replacement vector or insertion vector, therein you can see that it has got a Lambda C1 gene, which is responsible for maintaining the Lambda in the lysogenic mode. So in this region, if I introduce gene of my interest utilizing the EcoR1 gene, then we will see that we are inactivating the Lambda C1 gene. And if Lambda C1 gets inactivated, then it won't get into the lysogenic mode and it will go into the lytic mode. So this is how that Lambda insertional vectors can be created. Next is that the most important Lambda insertion vectors that are used are Lambda GT10 and Lambda GT11. The good part about it is that wherein we can package 7.6 kb of DNA. Then in Lambda GT11, we can package about 7.2 kb of foreign DNA. The foreign DNA is introduced at a unique EcoR1 cloning site, and Lambda GT10 is used to make libraries that are screened by hybridization. The interesting part about Lambda GT11 is that it contains a LAGZ gene driven by a LAG promoter. If inserted in the right orientation and right reading frame, the cDNA sequences which are cloned inside the Lambda GT11 can be expressed as beta-galactosidase fusion proteins and can be easily detected by immunological screening. Let's look into the chromosome map of Lambda. Herein, you can see that the non-essential region comprises of the B2 region, INT gene, XS gene, RED and GAM gene, and AT site. So, if I want to increase the insert size inside a Lambda cloning vehicle, then instead of going for an insertion vector, I will go for a replacement vector. Means I will replace this non-essential regions, and thereby this is called as the stuffer fragment, wherein I can introduce in exchange gene of my interest by deleting the non-essential regions of Lambda. So the most interesting Lambda replacement vectors that are used is called EMBL3 and EMBL4. Herein you can see that in EMBL3 the central stuffer fragment is of 14 kb in both of them. But here the basic difference is that the restriction endonuclease recognition sites are just reversed. What happens that once we are introducing gene of our interest inside those vehicles, the cloning capacity is much higher than that of insertion vectors. So herein you can see that how the real story takes place, that this bacteriophage Lambda DNA, we are discarding the middle part, which is the non-essential region, and instead of that blue region, we are introducing this red DNA, which is the foreign DNA, means our gene of our interest. And this green region gets inserted between the two arms of the Lambda, and they are packaged by in vitro packaging extracts, and they when infect the host cell makes many copies of these foreign DNA. Means green part of the DNA is being copied in many times when it gets inserted inside the host cell. So this is all about the cloning strategy using bacteriophage Lambda. But there are situations wherein we need to make for genomic libraries. Under such circumstances, the cloning capacity has to be increased further. And for that, Cosmid comes to our rescue, and we have got the cloning capacity of almost 45 kb inside a Cosmid vector. So what is basically a Cosmid? Cosmid is basically a plasmid containing two cos sites of Lambda vector. And in between these COS sites, we have introduced a plasmid with a multiple cloning site. And inside that multiple cloning site, we can clone almost 45 kb of the DNA. And this entire package called COSMIDs is in vitro packaged using lambda packaging extracts, and it infects the host cell by means of infection. And once it gets inside the host cell, it behaves like a plasmid. So in COSMID cloning, instead of looking for the clones inside the bacteriophage plaques, we will be looking for the clones in the bacterial colonies. As I said, that once they get inside the host cell, they behave like plasmids. Once this type of cloning is done with the E. coli host cell and bacteriophage vectors, we really need to focus on the cloning of a DNA wherein we need to get single-stranded DNA, as because single-stranded DNA is needed for the sequencing purpose. In this regard, the filamentous bacteriophages have played a vital role. Filamentous phages, namely F1, M13 and FD, all of them are called FP phages because they infect only those cells that bear PLUS. And what is so good about them? That they have got the capability to exist in the double-stranded state as well as in the single-stranded state. So, whatever modifications we want to do in the DNA, we can do by isolating the double-stranded DNA. Once modification is being done, they are packaged inside the filamentous phages and introduced inside the suitable hosts, wherein the single-stranded DNA is generated, which is essential to carry on the sequencing of the genomes using Sanger's dideoxy method of sequencing. Here you can see that how the single-stranded bacteriophage infects the cell, gets converted into replicative form utilizing the host RNA polymerase and DNA polymerase 3 genes. And once there is accumulation of P5 protein, it gets converted into the single-stranded state, and finally it is packaged again inside the proteins, coats, and it extrudes out of the cell without lysing the cells. This is something good about these phages, as because the cells are not getting killed. So we are coming to another variety of vectors wherein single-stranded phages are being utilized. Such a vector is called lambda zap vector. Compared to the lambda vectors, the plasmids can be easily manipulated in vitro, as we have seen. So, we have made lambda zap vectors, which is a fusion between a bacteriophage vector and a plasmid vector. What is so good about this thing is that P. bluescript is a plasmid which is introduced in between the bacteriophage genomes. The high capacity of 10 kb of foreign DNA can be cloned inside it. And the presence of polylinker with 6 unique restriction endonucleases are there. The availability of T3 and T7 RNA polymerase flanking the polylinker region is making it possible to transcribe the gene in both the directions. The cDNA clone can be recovered from the phage by simply co-infecting the cells with a helper phage F1. What it does that it nicks the lambda zap at the flanks of the plasmid, and it facilitates the excision of this plasmid, and now it can be excised off as a plasmid. So we have seen that how that M13 based vectors are playing a vital role in the cloning purpose and for making the single-stranded DNA. Now if we want to clone further larger fragments, then we go for bacterial artificial chromosomes. What are BACs? They can clone very large DNA fragments. BACs are used for making genomic libraries. It includes a replication origin that maintains the plasmid at 1 or 2 copies per cell, unlike other cloning vehicles which exist in multiple copies. But it has got a tremendous cloning capacity, and the power genes derived from the F plasmid are assisting the even distribution of the plasmids to the daughter cells. The selectable markers in the BAC vector are the LACZ gene for the production of enzyme beta-galactosidase and the chromophilical resistance gene, or the CAT gene. Introduction of recombinant BACs into the cell is done by electroporation and is promoted by making the cells more porous. You can see here that this is the picture of a bag wherein the F plasmid PAR genes are there, chloramphenicol resistance genes are there, and this large cloning vehicle can incorporate huge amount of DNA. And this entire recombinant bag is introduced inside the bacterial cell by means of electroporation. And we are selecting those recombinant cells by means of blue-white selection. You have gone through varieties of cloning vehicles, starting from plasmids, bacteriophage vectors, which may be insertional vectors or replacement vectors. Then we have focused on the importance of cosmids, and we have also emphasized the beauty of single-stranded bacteriophage vectors, namely M13, FD or FP. And finally, we have focused on the importance of bacterial artificial chromosomes.